Support for Steppin' Out comes in part from the Kristovich family in honor of Mary Lou and Bill Kristovich. This program is sponsored in part by the Eugenie and Joseph Jones Family Foundation, a local foundation proud to support the arts and culture in the greater New Orleans area.
Good evening, I'm Peggy Scott Laborde, and welcome to Steppin' Out, spotlighting the New Orleans area's arts and entertainment scene. Seated at our table tonight, Diane Sustendal Labouisse of the Louisiana Chapter of the French Heritage Association. Welcome, Diane, it's so good to see you.
Thank you, Peggy, it's lovely to be here.
Hello, same here. Poppy Tucker, host of the program Louisiana Eats, airing twice weekly on WWNO Radio. Hello, Miss Poppy.
Hi, Peg.
Hello. Elroy James, Mr. Elroy A. James, I should say, president of the Crew of Zulu, here to update us on the organization's events this year, including the parade. And he's also a past king, 2012.
Yes.
Good to see you. Hello.
Good to see
Welcome
you.
Welcome to our table.
Thanks.
And Alan Smason of Crescent City Jewish News and TheaterCriticism.com. But first, has Poppy got show and tell?
Well, last week you rang the king cake bell, and look what happened, Peggy. So I have some really amazingly delicious things to show you. And we're going to start off with probably one of the most aberrant of the king cakes. That would be from Cochon Butcher. That's the Elvis. And it's peanut butter, bananas, and marshmallow fluff, of course. And then also from La Boulangerie, which does the baking for Cochon Butcher, here is their traditional king cake. And help me, Peggy.
Absolutely.
This is just really too many king
you
cakes.
Betcha.
This king cake, as well as the Elvis, they come with the little rubber pig instead of the little baby. I love the pigs. I can't get enough of them. Then they also, at La Boulangerie, make the traditional gâteau de Reine, which is, of course, the queen's cake.
Yes.
And this cake, you see, isn't it beautiful?
It
the puff
is.
Pastry and the almond filling. And this one has the traditional little porcelain figurine as the favor. And look, it's a little jar of foie gras. Oh my goodness, it's
fev.
Just
I love the word
the fev. Me too.
Yes.
Now, hanging in over here, here we have the king cake from Station 6.
Ooh.
And it is a profiterole that is filled with king cake gelato from Piccola Gelateria. It's delicious. It's melting, but I think we'll make it through the show. And I also wanted to say that I spotted king cake gelato at Broccato.
Ooh.
So give
the lines
that a
are
try.
Get even longer.
Exactly. Then, now these people, the Randazzos, so famous for their king cakes. This is Randazzo's Camellia City Bakery. This is the strawberry and cream cheese, which is the favorite of Trisha Randazzo Zorns. They are amazing people over there. 11 flavors, including Royal, which is apple, lemon, cream cheese, and strawberry. And they come in sizes mini, small, medium, large, and super. And you'll notice that that tray with that unusual thing in the center, that anchors these king cakes because they ship them all over the country, all over the world very successfully. Every year they donate king cakes that go out to the armed forces everywhere.
Oh,
what wonderful
sweet.
People. Then let's talk about the innovations. Mayhew Bakery. Now this is Kelly Mayhew. This is the bakery, his new bakery on Orleans Avenue. And he's shown here showing his latest, that's king cake bread pudding.
Ooh,
that's a new
right
thing.
Right by Jeff, not too far from Jeff Davis. We
exactly,
yeah.
Right there very near the bayou. Jessica
yeah.
Williams is his associate baker there. And there's other delicious things right
Ooh.
There. Now his king cakes you can get at the King Cake Hub as well as the bakery, but at Mayhew, there's also satsuma and turmeric cake
Ooh.
By the slice. There's sandwiches for lunch. Great coffee program over there. Most days they're open from 7 till 3, open only till 2 on the weekends. So now, Peggy, here is my point. King cake is a flavor now. Like New Orleans flavors, nectar and wedding cake. Those aren't flavors anyplace else. And Quentin Quinovan of Quinton's All Natural Ice Creams at Dorignax. I caught him sampling his king cake ice cream, which is great. It's got pieces of cake in it, and it's not too sweet. Sometimes that's the king cake problem. Yeah. He also makes an ice cream filled king cake that you can order from him. It's gorgeous. And I think part of this rage for king cake flavor may have started with Max Messier of Cocktail and Sons. He created king cake syrup. That was his first seasonal flavor, and that's when king cake cocktails started popping up. But back 10 years ago, the Bourbon House, they're celebrating 10 years of their king cake bevy. This is the ultimate frozen king cake flavored milk punch that you can just take on a stroll right down Bourbon Street. And as a matter of fact, at all of Dickie Brennan's restaurants, there are king cake themed desserts. There's a bruleed king cake cheesecake at the steakhouse. There's something called tarte trapezine at Tableau. But my favorite, look what I have here. This is the do-it-yourself or decorate-it-yourself king cake from Acorn.
Let's pull that up a little bit. Yeah.
Okay, now watch how this happens. So you order it and it comes to the table. Imagine what happens when you've got like a three-year-old with you, you see? And so you've got the beautiful royal icing and you put it all over. And then you've got the beautiful little colors of purple. Oh, isn't it beautiful?
Do you have to buy that at the restaurant? Or
you buy it at the restaurant? I guess they would make it to go. That's a great idea,
but
Peggy.
But it's an Acorn at the Children's Museum.
Acorn at the Children's Museum. And look how beautiful this is. And when I picked this up, they told me, you should have been here earlier. Some poor mom was there with her little bitty who thought it was a good idea. Like, these were shot glasses. So the child was just shooting the colored sugar, and mama was saying, no, please, no. Isn't that adorable? Child doesn't want to make their own king cake?
The cuteness quotient, very high. Mm.
Thanks to everybody sent us this deliciousness.
Thank you very much.
King cake party after the show.
Yeah. Absolutely. Thank you very much. Great job.
Thanks,
great
Peg.
Job. And we turn to Diane, and with a little bit of a French twist here,
we're
with
the gazo,
organization.
So.
Absolutely. Yeah, well, you're right. There is a Louisiana chapter of a national association, the French Heritage Association. And tell us about what they do, especially here.
Well, their goal, they've been around since 1982, so they're not that old. And they are sort of like doing the most work for an organization we like to say no one's ever heard of. So thank you for having me so I can tell people about it. Our goal is we interface between 11 chapters in the United States and one chapter in Paris, and we focus on giving grants and monies to buildings and places and gardens, all of which have a French heritage in their DNA. And out of that comes supporting workmen who make gargoyles and masonry people and fine carpentry people. And so this is what we do. We just had a party at the Beauregard Guy's house on Sunday evening. It was an all-team Creole dinner catered by our friends Ralph Brennan, thank goodness, and it was delicious. Poppy, you should have been there.
For
the Leidenheimer's praline pudding, quite good.
But this is one of the homes that you all do contribute matching grants to?
Right, exactly. We gave them a $10,000 grant, and then we talked them up so much in our national meeting that Chicago is going to have a ball mask the Friday before Carnival, and they are sending their money down to the Beauregard Kai's house because we're redoing all their shutters across the front facade. And while you think that's simple, just go to whatever so-and-so shutter company. They all have to be handmade. And all the metal has to be hand-wrought to make it work and fit in to the placing of it. So there's a lot of detail. And I love the fact that it really helps keep these hand craftsmen, these petite mains, you know, working both here and in France.
And another recent project is the brand newly restored, an old home, but wonderful, on Royal Street with the Brulatour Signoret House.
And, which was WYES.
WDSU.
I'm sorry.
No, that's fine. 520
and,
Royal right
one
there.
Of your old
Look
homes.
Look at that.
Isn't it beautiful?
And you all helped with that renovation.
We did help with that. And it is spectacular. And I think what a lot of people don't know is it's free So there's no charge to go in, and it's absolutely spectacular. And we are thrilled, and it's lovely to work with the groups we work with. We work with the World War II Museum, the Jazz Museum, the Historic New Orleans Collection, the Degas House. There are about seven organizations, and the garden behind St. Louis Cathedral was redone. It is the oldest formal garden in the Mississippi Valley.
See, I didn't know that. St. Anthony's Garden.
It's St. Anthony's Garden. Yeah, it used to have that, you know, the tree where they would like shoot each other, and the, you know, dueling tree. That's removed now.
It's
so there you go.
Space.
But they redid that, and then every summer, and this is my very favorite part, is every summer they send six interns from Paris. And then we send interns over there, and they come, and the last new place to get them was World War II Museum, and they just love having them because they can translate all these documents. And so they're at Historic New Orleans Collection, they go over there, they're translating documents from 1700 because all the property transfers, everything was in French.
What a great thing. Now, if somebody would like to help, we have a full screen with the information for the French Heritage Association.
You can go to their website. You can go on their website. You will find out everything, all the wonderful things we do, and I can't thank you enough for having me.
All right. Yes, and French Heritage Association, absolutely, the society, and that would be FHS at FrenchHeritageSociety.org, and we so appreciate you all. I mean, the fact that you're raising money to help save these amazing buildings. So many, many thanks.
Thank you.
And New Orleans Magazine's quiz queen, Julia Street, has a question for us. Last time, Martin Mathey told us what famous bar was located across the street from the original Dixie Brewery. And what was the tower atop the nearby Falstaff Brewery noted for? Nick's original Big Train Bar, you could have said Nick's, was located across from the old Dixie Brewery. And the tower on top of Falstaff was known for providing weather info with the ball. Now, tonight's question. When the Saints played Indianapolis in the 2010 Super Bowl, who was the starting quarterback for the Colts? And what is his hometown? Email your answers to steppinout@wyes.org. Our prizes, a year subscription to Louisiana Life magazine. And we have a T-shirt with the message, Nice Legs, from our friends at wearablevegetables.com. We also have a pair of complimentary French Quarter walking tour tickets, courtesy of the Friends of the Cabildo. Go to thefriendsofthecabildo.org for more info. By the way, the Friends of the Cabildo, along with the Louisiana State Museum, are opening their vast carnival collection for a behind-the-scenes viewing of their Mardi Gras artifacts and their costumes. That's Wednesday from 5:30 to 7 at the museum's collection facility at 1000 Charter Street. General admission tickets, $30. Go to Friends of the Cabildo's website to purchase them. And, you know, you can go to wyes.org/steppinout for our online calendar, including the big treesy giveaway of 300 trees. That's tomorrow from 9 a.m. to noon at the Southern Food and Beverage Museum. And that, of course, is on Aretha Castle Haley Boulevard. The giveaway is for Orleans Parish residents only. Bring a picture ID. Each resident will receive one free tree. And all attendees will receive, this is a good deal, half-price admission to the museum. Go to nolatreeproject.org for details. By the way, you can link to WYES's YouTube channel to see our program. Now, Elroy, we've got some more show and tell.
Yes, Peggy.
And so exciting with the crew of Zulu and so many things happening. But what's really happening, speaking of king cakes, is you all have your own first king cake this year.
Yes, we're excited about a partnership that we connected with the Hyatt Regency Hotel. And the initiative is to find a way to increase our philanthropic activities in the area, in our space of scholarships. So we just recently announced a partnership where we have the official Zulu king cake that is being sold at the Hyatt Regency Hotel, and all the proceeds are going to fund the scholarship.
And you can go to the website, of course, for more information on that. Also, coffee?
Yes. Last year we had an exciting partnership with PJ's Coffee, right? And this partnership is, we also use those funds to promote our scholarship. So there's two brands of coffee out, quite naturally. One of the flavors is the Zulu coconut mocha coffee, as well as a Zulu blend that is a mild blend of coffee that is being sold throughout local markets and online at PJ's.
Now, you're a past monarch, but we have a new monarch.
Yes, yes. This year's king is Brian M. Sims. He's a 24-year member of the Zulu Associated and Pleasure Club, have served us in many capacities, largely last known as our picnic chairman, but he is also was responsible for many years for the Carnation Ball that you see that we are known to host. So he was our chairman of Carnation Ball activities for many years.
And we can't say who the queen is yet?
We are not allowed to say announce our queen until she's officially announced to the public, which is February the 9th. So we have a big, huge press conference that's going to take place at the new airport. So she will be arriving from Nashville, Tennessee this year with all the fun and fare that we are known to contribute.
And that's a tradition y'all have been doing really for quite a few years, when the queen arrives.
That's right. That's right. See, our king is elected by the membership, and Queen Zulu is officially allowed to be selected by the board of directors. However, the king, the elected king, can ask the board to relinquish his right. So this year, king, much like most of us have done, asked the board to relinquish their right, and we select the king, select the queen. And again, she will be brought to the public on February the 9th.
That's great. Yes. Now, what are some memories of your kingship?
I guess the biggest memory was I was 37 years old when I was elected as King Zulu, reigning at 38.
Is that one of the youngest?
Yeah, one of the youngest. And so having served 20 years in the organization at the time, so I guess one of the biggest memories is that the organization invested or believed enough to allow a 37-year-old young man to have the title of King Zulu.
I love that. And you brought us some show and tell?
Yes.
Got to have a coconut, huh, sir?
Correct. This year, our Lundi Gras Festival is the day before Carnival Fat Tuesday, and this is our official Lundi Gras coconut. So this is the golden nugget. This year we renamed our Lundi Gras Festival in the name of one of our founders. So it's the George B. Reigning Golden Nugget, Coconut Golden Nugget Festival. So also, Mardi Gras Day, the sought-after coconut that's going to be thrown from many of our floats. So this is a copy, a rendition of one of the coconuts. And also we have a variety of bees that is going to be thrown from the floats. And I think I would be remiss if I did not show the bee that of our King Club. This is an official bead of our King Club that will be handed out from the floats on Mardi Gras Day.
Oh, that's great. So crewofzulu.com for all the info, the Coronation Ball, Lundi Gras, all kinds of good things. And, of course, the parade.
That's right. That's right. Our parade rolls at 8 o'clock on Fat Tuesday, Mardi Gras Day. And so we're excited about the new themes that we're rolling out on this Mardi Gras. So this year, the parade theme is Zulu's Book of Love and Cinema.
All right. Thank you so much. Glad you could be with us, too.
Oh, my pleasure.
And now it is time for our artist spotlight. We are highlighting the Gallery 600 Julia exhibit, Bead Decked. This is L'Homme Sauvage by Herb Rowe. And we have Louisiana Chicken Feed by Larry Kip Hayes. The Scoop Show features carnival-themed artwork, as well as art depicting the career de Mardi Gras held in many Cajun communities. The opening reception takes place tomorrow from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m., and the exhibit runs through February 29th. It's a leap year. Go to gallery600julia.com for more info. Also, Roland Golden is one of many artists in a group show at McGrider Gallery on Julia. Now, Alan.
Well, I have to tell you, we're going to start off with something that's very, very interesting. That's at Southern Rep. And this is Entezaghi Shange's, they say translation, but it's actually her adaptation of Bertolt Brecht's play that he did called Mother Courage and Her Children. And why do I say that? Because I actually talked, and you'll see a picture later on, to the playwright's brother. And I asked him, I said, where did she translate this from? He said, well, she really didn't speak German. But I said, because that's a big question mark in my mind. So she actually took it from an English translation that had already been made and then adapted it. But she reset it in the post-Civil War Texas area. Mm-hmm. Now, this is what I would really call this an anti-war passion play. And Sarah Nansubuga there, who I've seen do some amazing work with other Southern Rep productions, et cetera, she's really the thing that the glue that holds this performance together. She's really wonderful. Mother Courage and Her Children, of course, is also the debut for Shivas Michael as director, who does an amazing
good
job.
Good actor, too.
Powerful work, you know, that really involves very inventive staging and lighting. Autumn Knight did the scenic design, and Brendan Connolly did this amazing sound design as well. But I got to, you know, shout out all of the people who are involved with this. Ilionette Bernabel, Lawrence E. Weber, who we saw earlier there, who was, of course, at Ain't Misbehavin'. We know of him really as a singer more than as as an actor. Raheem Glaspie, Donald Lewis, Mark Guillory, Alexis Selman, and Lakeisha Glover. They all play different parts. Some of them play just her children. Some play other different roles. But amazing work being done. And again, I just want to let everybody know, there she is again, Sarah, that this is really a very powerful play, and it's going to hit you in the gut. Now, right there on the left, you see the playwright's brother. That's Paul T. Williams, Jr. And there's Sarah in the center, who plays Mother Courage. And the other fellow on the right side there is Don Collins. He is the representative of the Antizaki Shange Revocable Trust. Those are the people that Aimé Hayes went to with this work and said, can we get permission to do that? They said, we don't think you can. And she got permission, and they were amazed. So yeah. Go see this. It really is an amazing thing. It's going to run through February the 8th, so only a little bit of time to see it at the Southern Rep stage. Meanwhile, over in West Wego, there's a little bit of a sex comedy going on called Viagra Falls. That's correct, Viagra Falls. It's two men, some blue pills, and a working girl. And again, it's got just about as many double and triple entendres, I think, as you can imagine. Directed by John Lowe. Now, amazingly, you'll see there the fellows who are there. Wayne Gonsolin plays Charlie Wilhouse, and his war buddy, David Jacobs, is Mo Krubs. And they invite this young lady to come in and sort of take care of things. That's Allison Logan. She plays Jacqueline Tempest. What a name. Now, here's the story. The reason why Charlie is interested in helping out Mo is that he's seen a medical report that may suggest that Mo's days may be numbered. So this is his sort of present to him, this girl. So that's the premise behind Viagra Falls. And the guy who did this, by the way, the director, is John Lowe. I ended up talking to him afterwards. He came in from California. And here's the amazing story. He says, yeah, I started as a stage director with Nona Nanette. I said, Nona Nanette, my God, Jack Guilford and all these other wonderful people had been the stage director for Pippin, John Rubenstein and Ben Vereen. And I said, well, how did you get that? He says, well, actually, I came home from the Vietnam War 6 months before. I was in the fields of the Mekong Delta, and what happened was there's a fellow in the living room trying to convince my mother to come out of retirement and do Nona Nanette. Who was your mother? Ruby Keeler.
What?
Oh yeah. So this guy's he's coming back. So
a
very famous actress. She was of course married to Al Jolson and 42nd Street. You can remember so many things about Ruby Keeler. Anyway, she of course very dear to me. He told me a little bit. She had actually a stroke. And she, 20 years later, she was still going strong and speaking as a spokesperson for the Stroke Association. Finally, I want to end with The Uninvited. This is something I really can't say so much about. This is an amazing work. And the reason why is because it is an immersive experience. This takes place on the very scene on which the play is supposed to be taking place. That, of course, is the Gallier House. And again, it's an immersive experience. You follow either the white family, the Galliers, or you follow the black servants, and all of their stories intermesh. Essentially, it's a story that's true. It's an incident that actually happened where there was a school next door that was segregated and then desegregated, and they tried to, I guess you may say, resegregate it. The White League came in. And again, you eavesdrop on all the different conversations. It really is an immersive, wonderful experience. I have a lot of things to say wonderful about the costumes, Chris Kamenstein's direction. But again, April Louise, who I also know is a singer from the World War II Museum, she is riveting as Charity. That's the main housekeeper. Tanya Rose is Rose, the school teacher, who's accused by the White League again, is also in there. Brian England plays a journalist named Moses, who's the love interest of Rose. And then finally, Ian Hawke and Dylan Hunter, amazing. Just great, great work there. And the best news is they have extended this into March. They're taking a break from Mardi Gras,
but it's
coming back in March, so go check that out.
Now, Alan, we know you wear many hats, but one in particular is around Mardi Gras. So show us that whistle.
All right, I get to show my whistle off. And again, you know, this is from last week. I was able to do the crew of Iris.
So you're their narrator?
I write the manuscripts, and they have all the stage directions, just like a play.
Various organizations for the balls.
And I do that. I'll be doing this again tonight. Of course, the crew of Argus is having their ball. Do the crew of Toth, the crew of Carrollton. I will also be doing some of the street parades, et cetera. Babylon.
At Gallier Hall.
Oh, yes, at Gallier Hall. And also the Intercontinental Hotel, where the official reviewing is. So if you don't know, you can hear the whistle. It's very, very loud, and very, very proud to say that this was a gift from my late wife. It's a military whistle.
Very sweet. Thank you so much, Alan. And now time for our picks. Diane. So, once again, interns, lucky interns.
Oh, they're so dear to my heart. I like you all with scholarship. Yeah. I just love the fact that educating people and getting kids college kids from France here and sending college kids over to France. It's just, I think travel broadens everyone and research does too.
Thank you, Poppy.
Well, if you're wondering where to see some of the Mardi Gras fun, the Felix Oyster Bar just announced that their Bourbon Street balcony is available with individual day passes February 21st through the 25th. And then, Peggy, you said nothing about my earring. And I wore these earrings. My dear friend Wesley Noble handmade them. And aren't they sweet?
They are. Fabulous. They are great. Elroy.
Well, Peggy, I have two picks.
Okay.
I'll be walking, leading the parade on feet. So look out for the president on Mardi Gras Day. And also, I want you to look out for our Junior Zulu. We have a mentoring program of young guys in the city. And so they will be riding on one of our floats in the Zulu parade, and they are officially our Junior Zulus.
I love that. Thank you.
And I want to mention my king cake baby as well that I wear. Sterling silver and one of a dear present again that I keep hold of. One of my good friends from the American Theater Critics Association, Christopher Ross, and out of Pittsburgh, named the series, the cycle of plays that August Wilson did, the Pittsburgh Cycle. And Joe Turner's Come and Gone, one of those plays, is going to be performed at the Samuel Dubois Cook Theater at Dillard University coming up from February the 7th through the 16th. Keep that in mind.
Okay, great. And before we go to my picks, we wanted to note the passing of guitarist and singer Billy Aspradides. He appeared on our show multiple times, and we will be showing an excerpt from a performance next week. We also learned that yesterday, Preservation Hall trombonist Lucian Barbarin, oh my goodness, he passed. And he was such a star of the New Orleans traditional jazz scene. He also played with Harry Connick nationally. Oh, very, very sad. And now my picks, Big Chief Victor Harris of the Fai Yai Yai tribe and Rachel Brunlin of the Neighborhood Story Project will discuss Black Indian masking traditions tomorrow at 2 p.m. at the Jean Lafitte National Historical Park in the Quarter, the visitor center there, right there on Decatur Street. Go to nps.gov/JELA to learn more. Also, our annual overview of the upcoming Mardi Gras season, Steppin Out, It's Carnival Time with Errol Laborde and Arthur Hardy premieres Monday night at 8 p.m. right here in WYES. Go to WYES.org to find many repeat airings. And finally, Chris Champagne will be performing his political satire, A Certain Girl, What's Her Name, Can't Trell Ya. Okay, political satire here. In a secret location next Friday at 8 p.m., huh? So to find out the location to RSVP, call 330-9117. Thank you all so very much for being here. And thank you for watching. Good night.
Support for Steppin' Out comes in part from the Kristovich family in honor of Mary Lou and Bill Kristovich. This program is sponsored in part by the Eugenie and Joseph Jones Family Foundation, a local foundation proud to support the arts and culture in the greater New Orleans area.